My name is Tanya Musumi, and I'm one of the regional managers at IFAC, where for the past year and a half, I've been getting to know and work with IFAC member organizations in Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and Southeast Asia. I also support the PAO Development and Advisory Group and initiatives on Islamic finance. Today's focus will be on the arrival of ISSB's S1 and S2, with a presentation and panel discussion among regional stakeholders who are actively developing local mechanisms for requiring sustainability disclosures. Our speaker includes a board member from the International Sustainability Standards Board, and our panel includes representatives of different sustainability-related boards and committees from the region. We do hope that you enjoy today's session. And if you have not already, I do encourage you to register for tomorrow's session, which will focus on the assurance of sustainability reporting information. And I will provide more information at the end of today's session. So first, I'd like to introduce Dr. Inki Ju, chair of the Jeju Group, to open up today's session. Dr. Ju, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Tanya. Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the today virtual sustainability summit webinar series hosted by IFAC in collaboration with ASEAN Federation of Accountants, AFA, Confederation of Asian Pacific Accountants, CAPA, South Asian Federation of Accountants, SAFA, and the Jeju Group. I am Inki Ju, chair of the Jeju Group, and it's a pleasure to have you all here. Firstly, I would like to express my deep gratitude to IFAC and our partners for their effort in ensuring the success of this event. I would also like to extend my sincere appreciation to our esteemed speakers and the panelists who will be sharing their valuable insight over the next 2 days. As we gather here for this virtual sustainability summit, I believe the timing is perfect, given the recent release of IWSB's IFRS S1 and S2, as well as IAASB's exposure draft on sustainability assurance. It is crucial to recognize that sustainability management is no longer a short-term trend, but a new paradigm and core strategy for business growth. Investors today understand that ESG values are just as important as financial values. This summit has been carefully designed to increase awareness and foster dynamic discussions about the growing demand for high-quality sustainability reporting and its assurance. Over the next 2 days, our speakers and panelists will delve into the impact of IWSB's first 2 standards and IAASB's exposure draft on sustainability assurance, ISSA 5000. Today, as we kick off day one, our focus will be on the introduction of IWSB's S1 and S2. We have an insightful presentation and a panel discussion planned featuring regional stakeholders actively involved in the development of local mechanisms for requiring sustainability disclosures. I'd like to thank Mr. Hiroshi Komori, an IWSB member, for his presentation today. The global accountancy profession has long supported the establishment of the IWSB to develop a comprehensive global baseline for the sustainability disclosures. The successful implementation of IFRS S1 and S2 is vital to fulfilling the IWSB's mission. We commend the IWSB for tackling climate-related matters, first with IFRS S1, S2, and for providing requirements in IFRS S1. That facilitate broader disclosure, investor-focused information on sustainability-related risks and opportunities. Now, with the introduction of S1 and S2, it is incumbent upon the profession to support their implementation. The conversations we have today will contribute to the global profession's ambitions in this field. While we are thrilled to deliver this event for the profession in the Asia-Pacific region, we also extend a warm welcome to stakeholders from diverse backgrounds, including investors, regulators, academia, and others. With that, I wish you all a fantastic day and urge you to make the most of this webinar. Thank you. Back to Tanya.
Thank you, Dr. Ju. I would like to now introduce Oki Pratama, Executive Director at AFA, to provide the first presentation. Oki, over to you.
Thank you, Tanya, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and friends, distinguished presenters, panelists and moderators, and of course, our chair of the Jeju Group, Dr. Inti Ju. It's good to see you again, Dr. Ju. Greetings from Jakarta, Indonesia. My name is Oki Pratama. I'm the Executive Director of the ASEAN Federation of Accountants, or AFA. It is truly an honor for me to speak at this very first IFAC Sustainability Virtual Summit for Asia Pacific in front of everyone joining virtually from around the world today. So on behalf of the ASEAN Federation of Accountants, or AFA, allow me to welcome and thank you for your commitment to join this two-day summit. Our appreciation also to IFAC and our fellow co-hosts, of course, Kappa, SAFA, and the Jeju Group for the opportunity to collaborate as well as bring together our collective network of member organizations, partners, and stakeholders to discuss a very important topic. Today is the beginning of our two-day summit on sustainability. So for AFA, it is a realization of our ongoing engagement with IFAC and of course our partners in the region to continue raising awareness and facilitating conversation about the surging demand for and the evolution of high-quality sustainability reporting and its assurance. Now allow me to set the stage for our sharing and discussion for day one, where we will delve into the impact of the International Sustainability Standards Board, or ISSB's first two standards, IFRS S1 and S2. Next, please. So, ladies and gentlemen, our involvement in today's summit began with a simple question. Why does the summit important for AFA? So as a regional grouping for professional accountancy organization of the ASEAN member states, we recognize the growing demand from our stakeholders for enhanced focus on sustainability, particularly on how this will impact the future of our profession. ASEAN governments too have stepped up their efforts in decarbonizing their economies. So the expectation is for the profession to play a bigger role in contributing to creation of an economic ecosystem that promotes sustainable and accountable growth. For AFA, today marks another important milestone in our sustainability agenda in Asia. As an IFAC network partner, one of our key priorities is, of course, to support adoption and implementation of international standards. The latest developments in sustainability disclosures and their assurance are without a doubt major priority for AFA and our member organizations. Now, following IFAC's call for a new sustainability standards board alongside the ISB in 2020, we have ramped up our efforts to bring the sustainability discussion to ASEAN. Our appreciation particularly to the IFRS Foundation and the ISSB and of course IFAC and our regional partners for their continued support and collaboration in organizing the many sustainability discussions and outreach activities in the region, presenting opportunities for our stakeholders to engage with the board and to share our voice. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure by now you've read many studies or reports on the state of sustainability reporting and perhaps its assurance. One of the more recent studies from our region was conducted by GRI ASEAN and the Center for Governance and Sustainability of the National University of Singapore Business School. So looking into 600 top 100 companies by market capitalization in Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam Stock Exchange. So published in July 2022, the climate reporting in ASEAN report highlighted 46% overall climate disclosure rate. So this was based on how the companies reported on key areas such as reporting framework, materiality, recent opportunities, governance, strategy, and performance. The report also highlighted how, despite sustainability reporting requirements continuing to expand across most jurisdictions in Southeast Asia, there is currently no common sustainability reporting framework across ASEAN. Though there is a preferred sustainability standard or framework that each country has posed or mandated, such as GRI or TCFD. So sustainability disclosure is indeed an alphabet soup of standards and frameworks. So ladies and gentlemen, based on our engagement and activities on sustainability in the region, there are three key observations that I would like to emphasize this morning. First, the future of corporate reporting will be all-encompassing of financial and non-financial reporting. So as highlighted in several studies, there is a growing demand for more integrated reporting of financial and non-financial information. And this requires a change in mindset for everyone participating in the ecosystem, you name it, preparers, auditors, users, etc., who understand that better information will lead to better decision. So high quality information is the fuel that capital markets run on. There are strong indications of jurisdictions moving in the direction of supporting the introduction of a global baseline for sustainability disclosures, i.e. the IFRS disclosure standards. Exactly why gathering such as today is important. The ISSB standards are much welcome in ending the alphabet soup of sustainability disclosures. And last but not least, I think we need to start thinking about the critical sustainability talent shortage. The need for capacity building, upskilling of our accountants is becoming more apparent as we continue with our sustainability journey. We look into IFAC, of course, and the IFRS Foundation's leadership in this space as we continue to educate our stakeholders in the region. Now, many of these sentiments were also recently highlighted in our FGD on ESG with CP Australia just last week. I certainly look forward to hearing Hiroshi's presentation today to understand how we can do our part to truly make the ISSB standards a global baseline for sustainability disclosures. Next, please. So, ladies and gentlemen, the same trends can also be seen in the wider Asia-Pacific region. There is definitely progress made in sustainability reporting practices. Recent analysis by KPMG in its Asia-Pacific edition of Sustainability Reporting Survey in 2022 revealed how Singapore and Malaysia are among the countries with the highest sustainability reporting rates for large companies, with leading firms in the Philippines fast catching up. Now, the Asia-Pacific region continues to dominate in presenting sustainability data in annual reports. This is consistent with what we see in ASEAN. So there is also a wide range of sustainability reporting practices in the Asia-Pacific region. I'm sure you're also familiar with IFAC's the state of play in sustainability disclosure and assurance. And with the recent edition of the Beyond G20 edition, there are now 12 Asia-Pacific jurisdictions included in the report. So there are Australia, China, Hong Kong, India, Indonesia, Japan, Singapore, South Korea, Malaysia, New Zealand, Philippines, and Thailand. Of course, you will hear more on this from David tomorrow, but allow me for today to highlight two important trends. The first one is that despite the current regulatory fragmentations, we are moving in the right direction. So regardless of differences in methods of reporting, standards and frameworks use, as well as a degree of assurance of sustainability reporting, more and more jurisdictions are showing intent towards looking into a global reporting baseline. Second, consistent with our observation for ASEAN, fewer companies rely on standalone sustainability reports. So while the use of integrated and annual reports for ESG disclosures increase. But don't take my word for it. I trust that we will hear more on this from our regional experts during the panel discussion today. So we have Dato' Kamarudin, Ibu Rosita, Yen San, Benjamin, Hiroshi, and of course our moderator, Julia. So I look forward to learning from them about their respective jurisdiction sustainability journey. and their experience in engaging with the different stakeholders. Also, to hear about how we can use this as an opportunity to build the right mindset of sustainability reporting and assurance as a value creation exercise. So it's not just reporting or compliance. Next, please. Excuse me. So allow me to conclude by referring to what is now a famous quote from Peter Becker, accountants will save the world. By now, I'm sure many of you have heard of this. So my question, what this actually mean? How are we saving the world? But now precisely what he meant and how it might be achieved has become more evident. Nature is a key stakeholder in our planet's future, yet it has no voice. So we can change that by giving nature a mandatory line in our report, starting with disclosures. So what can we do to achieve this? First, let us continue to advocate for sustainability. So each and every one of us has a role to play in encouraging our stakeholders to adopt transparent sustainability reporting practices. Don't forget as well about our stakeholders in the public sector. So we need to work closer with our regulators to establish smart sustainability-related policies and avoid any potential for further fragmentation. Second, continue spreading the word. Use your voice and leverage every communication platform that you have to raise awareness about the importance of sustainability reporting. Don't forget about our young generation, some of the future and emerging accountants. They are the one with the loudest of voice on the importance of building a more sustainable world. Number three, stay informed. Don't stop learning. Encourage your stakeholders to keep abreast of the latest developments in sustainability reporting. There are plenty of information and resources available. Many of which you will hear in the next 2 days in this summit. So from IFAC, IFRS Foundation, and then the ISSB, many of the PAOs and other partners. Next, don't forget about the assurance part of sustainability reporting. This will be the next important part of our discussion, and I would like to urge you to participate in day two of this summit tomorrow to hear from our experts about assurance. Specifically, the IIWSB's ongoing consultation on the proposed International Standard on Sustainability Assurance, ISA 5000, General Requirements for Sustainability Assurance Engagements. And last but not least, let us start talking about implementation too. Following the publication of IFRS S1 and IFRS S2, we need to pivot from standard setting to implementation. And this is one of our comments to the ISSB's recent consultation on its agenda priorities. It is important to demonstrate that we have the commitment from our global stakeholders for implementation of the standards before looking into publication of other sustainability standards. Next, please, Tanya. So, ladies and gentlemen, there can never be a more appropriate time for accountants to act on our responsibility and make a real difference. We can literally save the world. This is our moment. This is our calling. The accountancy profession has an important role to play in creating a transparent, accountable, and an unfragmented sustainability reporting and assurance ecosystem that can deliver real value to our stakeholders. Let us make sure that all of us can work together to get this right from the get-go. Thank you once again for your time, and I hope you will enjoy the rest of the summit.
Thank you so much, Wauke. That was very insightful. I would like to now introduce Mr. Hiroshi Komori, member of the International Sustainability Standards Board, to provide the opening presentation.
Thank you, Tanya, for the kind introduction today. So thank you very much indeed for having me today. My name is Hiroshi Komori, one of the members of 14 ISSB members from Asia-Oceania region, based in Tokyo at the Asia-Oceania office of the IFRS Foundation right now. And let me introduce myself briefly myself. I've got two backgrounds at the ISSB. One is investor side. I worked for GPIF, Government Pension Investment Fund in Japan, one of the largest asset owner in the world, and also a very much enthusiastic asset owner to the ESG activities in terms of very long-term asset management portfolio timeframe. And then the other one is that I used to be a ESG consultant to Japanese companies based on integrated reporting framework and also corporate governance. So I'd like to start my presentation based on those two, my background as well. So the next slide, please. We, as you know, we published our S1 and S2 on the 26th of June in London globally. And at the launch event over there, our chair, Emmanuel Favelle, emphasized one phrase: our language is accounting language. So this phrase explains what we worked for in the past nearly 18 months after the announcement of establishment of ISSB at the COP26 in 2021. We didn't work at all to add another new sustainability disclosure standard into the alphabet soup situation. What we aimed at was to establish a complete set of S1 and S2 as a sustainability-related financial information disclosure standards as a part of companies' general purpose financial reports. So this is our foundational attitudes, commonly the 14 members of the ISSB, throughout past discussions and going forward, I believe. So our direct mission was, in the middle of the, well, 3 points, to get everybody, mainly investors and companies, to get out of alphabet soup situation in a capital market. Based on my background on the investor side and corporate side, I really respect the tremendous effort and enthusiasm paid by our predecessors on both sides in the past 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, so long. So, simply the problem is too many disclosure standards and also too many initiatives in the market. So our mission is to integrate those hundreds of disclosure standards and initiatives in the market into one set of our S1 and S2 in the future. So we ideally expect this situation, and also in order to realize this one, we very much expect regulators and governments in the world to adopt our S1 and S2 as they are, and then put them into each jurisdiction's mandatory disclosure framework rules based on the support G20, G7, IOSCO, particularly IOSCO endorsed our S1 and S2 in July this year. So this is our mission. And the next slide, please. So with that, I believe the great benefit at the end of the day to be shared by both investors, left-hand side, and preparers on the right-hand side, based on the S1 and S2. So on the investors' side, I think that, for example, the GPIF asset managers in the world for Japanese equities and the global equities, and also alternative investment, as well as a fixed income bond. Everybody can enjoy the perfect comparable data disclosed by companies in the process of a decision-making process of short-term, mid-term, long-term investment time horizon. That minimizes the tremendous amount of the cost, which is monetary cost and also the personal human related cost as well in the investment side. And on the corporate side as well, I expect a situation in future that companies can easily deliver their disclosure directly to their shareholders and the possible investors in a capital market, which will affect their, and that those data would be efficient, effective to the future cash flow and as well as the cost of capital and also business model. So they are very material information and data to be evaluated by investors in a market. So at the end of the day, which means that more investment from the global investor side to be drawn by companies, equities, or reputation, and also corporate value at the end of the day. So this is the image we are now envisaging as a future ideal aspect. So in order to make this, in order to do this, we have set our S1 and S2 first principle-based standard, not a rule-based or something like that. So it is simply a principle-based standard which can be fully utilized by corporate people and also investors as well. So in that sense, in order to make further the conversation and the engagement between investors and corporate, I think that our S1 and S2 would be a great communication tool in a capital market between companies and investors in future. Next one, please. So we expect our S1 and S2 to be adopted by each jurisdiction as they are. That is our first wish right now. But at the same time, we very much expect for each jurisdiction regulator to add their own, restrictions, further restrictions, regulations onto our S1 and S2 based on our building blocks idea concept. So we welcome the both pattern, but anyway, we would like to keep our S1 and S2 as a global baseline standards, which meets the investors' the needs in a capital market. So our standards below the bottom line of this slide, we provide a comprehensive foundation of disclosures for global jurisdiction adoption. And our S1 and S2 are a common language, which is important for us for comparable decision useful disclosures. And also we design to make S1 and S2 to meet investor needs across global capital market. Next one, please. So in order to accomplish our mission and our target, we decided to integrate the eminent and the well-known and the well-established standards and initiatives from the market. The first one is the integral reporting framework, and the second one is the SASB standard, and also CDSB concept, and as well as the TCFD recommendations. In addition to that, to them, we made a MOU with GRI and CDP, so companies can enjoy their experiences, which already familiar with the company's disclosures in the past. And in this sense, I very much believe that companies in the Asia Oceania region can enjoy a great advantage, as Oki explained in his explanation, that very many high percentage of the companies, particularly large cap companies in this region, already made a great great disclosures based on integrated reporting framework using SASB standards and based on CDSB, TCFD, four core elements, and as well as the TCF. CDP and the GRI survey. So I emphasize this is great advantage in this region compared with the other regions on the in the world. So our next one, next slide gives you the structure of S1 and S2. In my understanding, S1 is a mother standard, which deals with every sustainability topics, which might affect the future cash flow and cost of capital, and also business model on a short term, long term, mid term on a corporate side. And then our stakeholder asked us to focus on the climate issue first of all. So then we took out the climate related matters from S1, named S2. So we are now having further public consultations, such as the biodiversity or human capital or human rights or something like that in future. So maybe we will make up S3, S4, 5 or something like that. But at every occasion, S1 is a mother standard for them. So we very much appreciate if the jurisdictions deals with the S1 and S2 as a in the process of mandatory disclosure standard making. And for S1, we used TCFD architecture for core elements, corporate governance, strategy, risk management, and target and metrics, and as well as industry-specific disclosure SASB standard. And next, please. Therefore, we use the same structure TCFD recommendations as a base concept of S2. And also we made the appendix B of S2 as a using the SASB standard as well, particularly especially for climate change issues. Next one, please. So referring to the mechanism, we, as I said, we use well-known terminology and the concept based on the initiatives and the standards. And also we added the new concept without undue cost or effort in order to make our concept proportionality to particularly for mid and small cap companies in the market, everywhere in the market. But we need to also consider on our side, we need to provide skills or capacity building or guidance, several kinds of guidances or something like that, as well as the bottom line. We set up transitional reliefs current on the S1 and S2 right now. And next one, please. So basic, very grateful support from the IOSCO. We are now acting very much, working very hard. And as well, of course, audit standard setters, jurisdictions, market participants, and accountants as well. So last page, we are now looking ahead. Next page, to commit connections with financial, to keep connections with financial statement, as Emmanuel emphasized. So we also need to be careful about interoperability. So I just need to current situation of interoperability with DRI and FRAG, ESRS and CFDR. Unfortunately, it is very difficult for us to announce when we will agree with the GRI and the FRAG to saying that we made up this type of interoperability framework and the details of interoperability, one paragraph, something like that. So, but the top three of ISSB, GRI, and FRAG already agree that our responsibility is to minimize additional burden of dual disclosure on the corporate side as much as possible. So therefore, We have been very working very hard, very much. But as I said, this is not at the moment. It is difficult for us to say when and how and what at the moment. But we would like to announce as soon as we agree, we make agreement with each other. And we are going to add some other tools such as digital taxonomy, which is really important for the corporate side and the investor side as well, to make a streamlined flow of disclosure data and narrative information in the capital market. And we also need to increase awareness and also set up a capacity building as well. And we also expect regulatory people's adoption and voluntary application for the time being. So as a future priority, I very much appreciate the great valuable comment letter towards our agenda consultation, which closed on the 1st of September, and also SASB internationalization application public consultation, which closed last month. So, and we are now in the process of public consultation of the digital taxonomy as well. So we very much, particularly myself, as the one of the ISSB member based in Tokyo and covering the AO region, I think that in order to deliver your voices from this region, your comment letter is very, very valuable to me and to the board member as well. So I expect that towards a further public consultation by ISSB, I very much expect your comment letters as well in future. And in terms of agenda consultation, we've got quite a few, more than 430 comment letters worldwide for ISSB to opt biodiversity or human capital or human rights and integration reporting framework as well. So probably from the end of this year, we will begin our formal discussion at the ISSB board meeting on a public basis towards the first quarter or second quarter of 2024. We received huge voices from the market. So our staff has been very working hard right now to analyze and to evaluate one by one right now to make a report to us. So let me stop here and look forward to the panel going forward. Thank you very much indeed.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Mr. Okumori. And I appreciate your remarks. And so, yes, let's move on to the panel discussion. So I'll just begin with a few introductions. And so I'd like to first introduce our moderator for the session, Julia Tay from EY, who's an Asia-Pacific public policy leader with nearly three decades of professional experience. She juggles regulatory and public policy matters across 20 countries from her base in Singapore. And she's got a very diverse background spanning audit, commerce, government. And so that provides her with a unique lens through which to guide our discussion today. We're also joined by Chen Yan San. And as a prominent member of the Sustainability Reporting Advisory Committee, Ms. Chan plays a vital role in shaping the future of mandatory sustainability reporting in Singapore, reflecting the committee's profound influence in sustainable business practices. And adding to our panel's depth is Rosita Ulisinaga, and she is a council member at the Institute of Indonesia Chartered Accountants, and as the chairperson and a key initiator of IAI's Task Force for Comprehensive Corporate Reporting since 2020, Rosita has been at the forefront of sustainability reporting evolution in Indonesia. We also have Datuk Komarudin Hashim, and he is the Managing Director of the Securities Commission Malaysia, steering the strategic direction of the Malaysian capital market. And he also chairs the Advisory Committee on Sustainable Reporting for Malaysia and co-chairs the Joint Committee on Climate Change, representing a cross-sectoral approach to climate concerns. And then I'm also introducing Benjamin Villacot, and he is the chair of the Philippine Sustainability Reporting Committee. And he also brings with him 18 years of experience at SGV & Co. And he's navigating both accounting and sustainability, aiding clients from local to ASEAN landscapes in areas like climate change, sustainable finance, and sustainability reporting. And concluding our panel is Hiroshi Komori as a pivotal member of the International Sustainability Standards Board and the driving force behind Japan's GPIF sustainability initiatives. Hiroshi also brings a wealth of depth and experience. And so for those of us who had the privilege of hearing his earlier presentation, you'll recall the profound insights he shared. So during this discussion, we encourage you to engage. And should you have any questions for our panelists, we would kindly ask you to drop them in the Q&A box. So I will hand this to Julia, our moderator. Thank you.
Thank you, Tanya. Good morning, everyone. It's an honor for me to welcome our esteemed participants and distinguished panelists to today's panel discussion. Thank you very much also to Oki and Komori-san for such insightful presentations before this. This session promises to be a dynamic and insightful discussion centered around the adoption of the ISSB standards in this region. Our distinguished panelists are all key members of regional sustainability reporting policy setting mechanisms, and therefore they are well placed to share insights from their ongoing work in establishing roadmaps to adopt ISSB standards in their respective jurisdictions. Before I dive into the panel, I would like to again talk about the sustainability reporting and assurance policy landscape in APEC. Oki had given a little glimpse of that just now. So as an Asian, I love how APEC is so diverse and rich in culture. We have a mix of races, religion, and at least 14 languages spoken across more than 23 countries. But as a public policy practitioner, I find it challenging to navigate the regulatory fragmentation across APEC. So as you can see on this slide, with respect to sustainability reporting and assurance, we now have quite a fragmented landscape in several aspects, whether reporting is mandatory and the framework used, and whether assurance is mandatory and the scope and standards used. However, I'm glad that the ISSB standards will now be a unifying force. Several countries on this slide are already making policy changes, and we have a bright pathway towards the adoption of ISSB standards in APEC. Our panel discussion will be structured around four key themes. Firstly, we want to find out from our panelists what are the driving factors behind the establishment of the various sustainability reporting policy setting mechanisms, whether they are boards, committees, or task forces. Secondly, we want to hear from them what they think are the critical success factors needed to pivot from standard setting to implementation. Right. And thirdly, we want to understand what are the capacity building initiatives in the region. And lastly, given that this is an IFAC event, we really want to also hear from them whether we have a role for professional accounting organizations or PAOs in supporting the sustainability agenda. So as Tanya said, I urge all of you to engage actively throughout this panel. Your questions and insights will be invaluable, and we encourage you to submit your queries as we progress. And during the final optional segment of our panel, we'll have dedicated time to address your questions directly. So thank you, and let us now begin our panel discussion. So Komori-san, thank you so much for sharing about the IFRS S1 and S2. And so to kickstart the discussion, may I ask the other panelists, first of all, to share what is your jurisdiction's plan to adopt the ISSB standards and the estimated timeframe, and also to share the vision of your respective committees and tell us the key considerations in your respective roadmaps that will help to achieve that vision. So maybe I can start off with Yen-san.
Thanks, Julia. So in the Singapore context, I think, you know, the most recent key milestone in terms of the Singapore Sustainability Reporting Roadmap is the consultation paper that has been issued by the Sustainability Reporting Advisory Committee, or the SRAC in short. And this consultation paper is a critical milestone in Singapore because it will mandate climate-related reporting and disclosures beyond listed companies in Singapore. So what this means is that it is the first time we are going to mandate even non-listed companies to prepare and disclose climate-related disclosures, right? In terms of the standard to be applied, the proposer has a long-term vision of aligning with the ISSB standards for international conversion. But as a start, in order to ensure that there's sufficient capacity building, as well as to make sure that, the climate issues get addressed first, given the urgency, the committee has proposed, to focus on climate-related disclosure first as a start. And the reporting timeline that this is going to come in is that for listed companies, the mandatory reporting will be from financial year 2025. For non-listed companies with revenue of at least $1 billion will be mandated to report from FY 2027, 2 years later. So the plan is that the SRAC will review in terms of the scope of companies to be reporting under this mandatory requirement with a view of reducing the threshold for reporting to $100 million by around 2030. So in terms of the roadmap, that has been clearly specified in the consultation paper. The other aspect that is critical is in terms of the assurance part. The consultation paper also set up a roadmap in terms of assurance. This will enhance the credibility of a climate-related disclosure as well as, in time to come, the sustainability report as a whole. The long-term vision is to have a full reasonable assurance on the entire climate and sustainability report. But as a start, the SRAC proposed Scope 1, Scope 2 to be subject to limited assurance 2 years after mandatory reporting kicks in. So that will be the plan and the roadmap that is proposed by the SRAC paper. I think this is an extremely important milestone in the Singapore context, and it has triggered a lot of discussion. And this actually gave a good signal to the company of when mandatory reporting to come and encourage company to start capacity building as well as start preparing for the mandatory reporting in times to come. So maybe, Julia, I'll just pause here.
Yes, thank you very much. So I think I called on Yen-san first because there is already a roadmap that is being consulted. But in the Philippines, in Indonesia and Malaysia, although there's not yet a roadmap that's being announced, but I think the committees are already formed and there are already plans underway. So maybe if I can go to the next lady, Ibu Rosita, maybe you want to explain what are your thoughts surrounding the two questions that I posed. Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. So I think for Indonesia, it's very different stage compared to Singapore. Let me share first the background why the Indonesian Institute of Chartered Accountants, or II, created Comprehensive Corporate Reporting Task Force. So it began in September 2020 when IFAC published a proposal enhancing corporate reporting, the way forward, where IFAC calls for a new sustainability standard board alongside the ISB, and also the IFRS Foundation consultation on sustainability reporting. I think that's the milestone that us in II envision that this is going to be the new era of comprehensive corporate reporting, which will be all encompassing of financial and non-financial reporting and will end the alphabet soup issue. At that time, we believe this is the time that we as accountant profession to support and lead this initiative. Therefore, in September 2020, II established the Indonesia Task Force of Comprehensive Corporate Reporting as a platform to gather all stakeholders in Indonesia to drive and support this initiative in Indonesia. Then, fortunately, this task force got support from all relevant key stakeholders in Indonesia, representative from Financial Service Authority, Central Bank, Ministry of Finance, the Ministry of State-Owned Enterprises, Indonesia Stock Exchange, Chamber of Commerce and Industry, representative for preparers, and also two other accountant profession association are member of this task force. Then since 2020, this task force has been very influenced and actively involved in various initiatives to drive the sustainability reporting, the new era of sustainability reporting initiative. Some of the significant milestones that we want to share is we intensively contribute along with the IFAC in policy recommendation in B20, G20 2022 in Indonesia. And also this task force also representing Indonesia in IFRS Global South Roundtable. And up to now, I can say that this task force become a platform to gather all inputs and comments letter representing Indonesia view to the ISSB. Now, because of this driving by the task force, I think we can convince the III members in its 2022 Congress to agree to mandate II to establish a sustainability standard board along with support from other stakeholders. Now, it is hoped that this board will collaborate intensively with, we call it the Sustainable Finance Committee, which under the mandate of Law Number 4 of 2023, this is the new mandate, which is issued in early 2023. We have the new committee, we call it Sustainable Finance Committee, consists of various regulators, which one of the role is to support the development of the standard. So I think this is the stage. So we in the II developed the board, and also in the government perspective, under the new law, there will be sustainable finance committee, which will be the umbrella to support all the sustainability reporting initiative. I think I will pause this, Julia.
All right. Thank you, Ibu. We've heard from Ibu Rosita, and she comes from the perspective of sort of driving this from a professional body. And next, I wanted to call on Dato, because you're sort of chairing it from a securities regulator perspective. And I wanted to sort of hear if that will be a different from driving it from a professional body perspective. Thank you.
Thanks, Julia. I think we are working towards the same cause. So for Malaysia, I can say that our coordinated efforts really started through this Joint Committee on Climate Change, or JC3, we call it, set up 3 years ago. This JC3 is essentially is co-chaired by the Central Bank and the Securities Commission Malaysia. And it is a collaborative effort with industry participants to accelerate response and measures that will support a smooth and orderly transition to a low carbon economy. In terms of governance, for example, the Malaysian Code on Corporate Governance is also one of the few codes which since 2021 has included best practices specifically on sustainability. So I'm just, you know, we have the, some quick background in terms of where we have started, you know, and in terms of specifically on the implementation of the ISSB standards, we saw the need to establish what we call the Advisory Committee on Sustainability Reporting, or ACSR. It's a national committee, and this is needed because of the implementation need on the ISSB. Is an interagency committee with members comprising representatives from the stock exchange, the central bank, our audit oversight board, the companies commission of Malaysia, which is the company's regulator, and also the Financial Reporting Foundation, which oversees the Malaysia's accounting standards board. So the AACSR actually was also set up with the endorsement of the Ministry of Finance. So what the AACSR has agreed at the beginning is to adopt a phased approach, which would allow for scaling and phasing in of our requirements. So starting first with companies that are listed on the stock exchange, given the investor-focused design of the ISSB standards. So such measured approach is not new. The first set of sustainability reporting requirement for listed companies was introduced back in 2015 and it was also implemented on a phased approach, taking effect first for companies with market cap of 2 billion Malaysian ringgit. Similarly, is the case for enhanced sustainability reporting requirements, which the stock exchange issued in November last year. The disclosure requirements come into effect in stages and culminates in TCFD-aligned disclosures for annual reports issued for financial year end 31st December 2025 onwards. So for Malaysia, we do recognize the expediency, that expediency is key given the climate urgency, but we need to choose the right pace to ensure we get the approach and infrastructure right from the get-go. So I was recently reminded about the risk of setting up a new framework or design, etc. That if we start on the wrong footing, it can potentially be a costly affair to remediate it. So I think that was that is not specifically on what we do now, but in general, because there are other frameworks that the SCE, for example, are working on. So that reminder, was kept on being told to me. So maybe I'll stop from there on that. Thanks, Julia.
All right. Thank you, Dato. I think what I'm hearing really is about three key themes that have come up so far. So first of all, the importance of aligning country to global, right? I mean, country jurisdiction policy to global standards. Secondly, what I'm hearing is that a lot of countries are sort of thinking about proportionality or phasing in. And lastly, I think I'm hearing that all of the committees are multi-stakeholder, that there's multi-stakeholder representation, including having the accounting profession at the table. So that's really good. So last but not least, Benji, can I invite you to talk about the situation in Philippines?
Thank you, Julia. And actually, you have summarized all the important points already. But for the Philippines, we started in 2019 and we followed the comply or explain approach for publicly listed companies. So that's a three-year transition period, which ended in 2020. So supposedly 2022, that was the first year sustainability reporting became mandatory for publicly listed companies. Now it's 2023, and we have ISSB issued last July, and the Philippines is also positioned to adopt in full ISSB, being an IFRS reporter for financial mm-hmm. statement. And this action is being led by the Board of Accountancy. And the Board of Accountancy created this committee, the Philippine Sustainability Reporting Committee, which I chair. And we are 17 members, so the big accounting firms. We have regulators, the SEC, the Central Bank, the Climate Change Commission. We also have the business associations and academe. So we have intentionally included academe because we have to take care of the supply side also. We need more sustainability practitioners in the market, and we need to enhance also the curriculum and, I guess, training of future accountants. Okay, so what we have discussed in PSRC is to adopt in full ISSB as they are, but toy a bit on the effective date. So probably the target is to adopt by January 1, 2025. So that is a year later than the global effective date. Now, so between now and January 1, 2025, the SEC is updating their sustainability reporting template. So the one they issued in 2019. So they are revisiting that. So they have already incorporated the bits and pieces of ISSB requirements in that sustainability plate. And the plan is to circulate that for, feedback and consultation from reporters and users of sustainability reports. And that would sort of act as a bridge between the current type of sustainability reporting that we use and the full ISSB come 2025.
All right. Thank you, Benji. That's a really real practical help to help with the implementation. So thank you very much for all your comments regarding my first question. I'd like to move on to the second one in the interest of time. So obviously, you know, you have all formed your task force looking into roadmaps, but I'd like to sort of hear from you what we think are the critical success factors needed for successful implementation, right? So like what Oki said in his opening introduction, how do we pivot from standard setting to implementation? So since all of you have spoken now, I will give the opportunity to Komori-san. Right, Komori-san, the sustainability standards in the US and EU are actually required by the US SEC rules or the EU CSRD, but the ISSB standards must go through a process of local adoption. So from an ISSB perspective, what are your hopes or wish lists when local jurisdictions are adopting standards promulgated by a global standard setter?
Right. Thank you, Julia, for the great question. We've got actually a lot of wishes at the moment, but top one is that anyway, we would like to keep our S1 and S2 as a global standard, which will, we believe that certainly, definitely meet the needs of the investors in the capital market, and then which will lead the great benefit to the corporate side as well, in the investment chain in the global market. So that is one thing. And we also, as I said in my presentation, that we would like to keep a structure of S1 and S2, or S1 and S2, S3, S4 in future as well. So I understand the situation at each country that the top priority, it could be, say, climate change issue or something like that. But S2 is a standard for, say, climate change related, specifically data gathering standard. And then for investors, it is important for them to evaluate and analyze what process internally at each company made the decision of say, reduction target or scope 3 GHG emissions and target or something like, or resilience or something like that. So behind the S2, S1 exists as a basic say guide for the companies to disclose their thinking process, decision process, corporate governance processes to support the S2. At the end of the day. So this is our basic structure. So we would like to keep this point, but I'm very much encouraged listening to today's panelists' explanations one by one. So I can see a great momentum in this region. And I say not only Singapore, Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines, I would like to add Japan, Korea, China, as well as Hong Kong, Australia, and India as well, and Taiwan as well. So many countries, jurisdictions already start to move ahead despite the each country's say issues or topics or something like that. But we very much welcome this great say movement and the momentum in this region very much, yeah. So I'm very much encouraged listening to this today. So, and also we are a little bit scared about to the chance to be, say, diversely interpreted at each company's jurisdiction people, even though it is based on S1 and S2. So in order to do that, we set up Transition Implementation Group consists of 17 members last month, including the 4 or 5 members from Asia Oceania region, including our content people. So this will be a great supporter for us, I believe, to fixed any interpretation questions or issues on the particular on S1 and S2 when we have a say questions from you and from other say countries in this region. So this is our idea at the moment. Thank you, Julia.
All right. Thank you, Komori-san. I think it's really encouraging that we do have a bright pathway towards ISSB implementation in this region. And really glad to, you know, hear your point about the mechanisms that will help to avoid interpretation differences. Now I thought I want to turn to the rest of the panelists. Right. So first of all, I wanted to sort of discuss this thing. The IFAC has defined four pivotal challenges facing the accounting profession when it comes to supporting the sustainability agenda. And these are one, championing an integrated mindset within companies; two, building a global system and adopting ISSB standards; three, capacity building; and four, preparing for high quality assurance. So as each of you in your jurisdiction help to develop the roadmap for sustainability reporting and assurance, right, what do you think will be the critical success factors needed for successful adoption and implementation that will address some or even all of these challenges? This time around, I can start off with Benji first.
Okay, thanks, Julia. I guess from my point of view and seeing it also in practice, it is important to really have the right mindset and not look at maybe the ISSB adoption or even sustainability reporting as another compliance burden or another reporting burden for companies. So as it is right now, financial reporting is still a challenge for many companies, even with decades of adoption of IFRS. So there's still room for improvement. So I would begin with, having the right mindset and look at ISSB and sustainability reporting as a tool to create and enhance value for the organization. So it's not really a reporting exercise, but something, a strategic tool that management and the board can make use of. And secondly, it will be, accepted by the organization if it is also used in risk management, especially a lot of the environmental risk and social risk. All this will translate into financial risk. So if you speak in terms of numbers, pesos and dollars, you'll be able to have the attention of the board and management. And in that way, appropriate strategies will take shape. And in that way, transformation will also start within the organization. I guess that's really the success indicator if we see transformation within the organization and not just, glossy reports at the end of every year.
Thank you very much. Well said. Turning to Ibo Rusita.
Thank you, Julia. I think for the perspective of Indonesia, I think I agree with Benji on the change on the mindset. I think I have to respond on this. The first dimension is my concern, not only for Indonesia, for all other jurisdictions, on how to ensure we can achieve certain level of global harmonization of sustainability reporting in, at least in climate change first, right? This is very important key success factor. If at the end of the day, every country has their version of the sustainability reporting, I think this is going to be a bottleneck for everybody to go to that direction, right? So in this case, I believe we need to create a global sustainability reporting ecosystem, which consists of all representatives of various key stakeholders representing all regions and regulator, which structurally can able to communicate and collaborate. I don't know who should be drive this. I don't know whether it is ISSB or other global regulator, but this is very, very important. So, for example, when we convince regulator in Indonesia, right, it is easier if somebody, which is also global regulators, which they usually speak to, has the same language, right? And have the same tone. I think that's the very important key success factor. And number two, from the Indonesia perspective, is because we are at the different stage compared to other countries, currently our regulator sustainability reporting is mostly is GRI framework. Now we have to transform our sustainability reporting to the more investor focus with TCFD and SASB related framework, which is used by SSB to formulate the S1, S2, it is very big gap. Therefore, I think number one, we need to have all key regulator support, because now it is under POJK 51-2017, right? I think we need to have a change on that so we can support to implement the S1, S2 for the ISSB. And also because under Indonesia, there are some regulator which relevant to this sustainability reporting. We have Financial Service Authority, we have Directorate General of Tax, we also have Ministry of Environment and Forest, which need to have one page about this direction. Therefore, the II will drive this to ensure we have the same page and tone to drive this angle. Number two, from the perspective of the company, currently at this stage, I think agree with Benji, everybody think this sustainability reporting is not part of the CFO things, right? So I think I really intensively communicate with the CFO forum, because this is going to be a huge alignment between the financial reporting and sustainability reporting. I think the CFO need to be aware about this and understand about this, and also build the capacity on this. I think that's the big change that we need to drive, Julia.
All right. Thank you. I've just received a message from Tania to sort of remind us of the time. So because we want to cover as much as possible, maybe I'll just turn it quickly over to Dato, and then Yen San can finish off this question. Yeah, Dato.
Okay, thanks, Julia. I think there are various factors which are critical in terms of implementing something of this significant. But I think we'll just cover on two key areas. And one is that coordination in terms of standard setting and oversight is critical at both the international and domestic front to avoid unnecessary and costly fragmentation in regulation. So fragmented regulation comes with a price tag. Not only that, it's always coupled with the growing cries of reporting fatigue and caused by corporates. So and, as a market regulator, this is all familiar issue given the many, many other reporting, regular reporting that our regulators and market participants are subjected to. So I think the establishment of the ISSB and the issuance of the two standards is a significant step forward in addressing the fragmented landscape of sustainability reporting standards. To mitigate the risk of fragmentation and formulation, we think that the ACSR, the committee in which I chair, brings together the main stakeholders vis-a-vis sustainability reporting in the financial sector to collectively identify the best approach and framework to roll out the ISSB standards in Malaysia. Secondly, I think we need participation by almost everybody, all stakeholders in the process. The canvas on which the committee is working on to develop the roadmap is big, involving interplay of various factors, from looking at the cost of compliance to identifying the regulatory risks and oversight considerations. For this reason, we also have formed a consultative group of 50 members comprising representatives from listed companies, accounting firms, insurance providers, investors group, and as well as SMEs to provide feedback on these critical issues. This is to ensure that our committee benefits from the stakeholders' views and challenges right from the beginning. I think I did mention about we particularly very places a high importance in terms of getting our food, you know, in terms of setting the stage right. So I think this is very important for us. And in addition to this consultative group, we're also planning a wider public consultation next year. So I would also like to add on the point on the integrated mindset. In Malaysia, we are fortunate to have the Integrated Reporting Committee under the Malaysian Institute of Accountants, or MIA, which was formed following a recommendation in the SC's Corporate Governance Blueprint in 2011 to look into integrated reporting. So the committee has been actively supporting the adoption of integrated reporting by Malaysian companies and continue to promote an integrated mindset within companies to break down the silos of information and promote connectivity between financial and non-financial information. So since 2019, the MIA, Malaysian Institute of Accountants, has provided capacity building and technical assistance for over 900 individuals, including directors, those in the finance function, and corporate communication. Okay, I'll stop there, Julia.
Yeah, thank you for your comments. I particularly like your comment about the integrated mindset, because that will surely help to future-proof the roadmap that you're planning. Yeah. And last but not least, Yen-San.
Julia, thanks. So, you know, I agree with, you know, all that has been said by the panelists, including a few very important things. Number one, harmonization of standards, both from the reporting perspective as well as from the assurance perspective. I think that is critical. In addition to that, also harmonization of timeline of adoption of the standard by various jurisdictions, that will also be critical in order to trigger, you know, the move towards adoption of both the reporting standard as well as the assurance standard. Second thing about the mindset, I totally agree that, you know, there is a whole change management that needs to happen right from the top all the way down to the bottom. And people is, in fact, the most important part of this whole exercise. Therefore, developing people and developing capacity is, in fact, you know, the backbone to the rest of the initiatives that we need to push out. And therefore, you know, I think we need to focus a lot on capacity building, people development, as well as mindset change in order to drive this initiative. I think this is a very important critical success factor, you know, for all of us here. And I think accountant has a big role to play. Right, we have been through this process, you know, quite, you know, in fact, many times with changes in accounting standard, and I think we can make this happen with the reporting standard for sustainability. So maybe, right. Julia, I'll pause here.
Thank you for providing me a good segue to my next question. Actually, you know, Oki had said upfront in his quote, right, accountants can save the world. So I think accountants can deal with sustainability. So just sort of moving to my next theme, I think capacity building is indeed important, as what Yen-San said, and is definitely going to be a critical success factor. So maybe I can invite each of you to share what is the approach to capacity building in your jurisdiction and provide some examples of key initiatives. And also please feel free to share some of the best practices that you have observed from the other jurisdictions. Yeah. So maybe this time, Benji, I'll start off with you.
Thanks, Julia. I guess as they say, there's really no sense crossing the finish line if you will be alone there or no one else is with you. So I guess it's important that we look at this whole nation approach, especially small and medium-sized entities. So for Philippine market, at least that comprises at least 90% of the corporates. And this type of entities also employ the most number of people. So in terms of impact, it's really through making sure that SMEs also catch up to this type of thinking and reporting. So so for the SEC in their roadmap, while we start with publicly listed companies, there are also plans to capacitate and build capacity for small and medium-sized entities. And other agencies have started creating technical working groups where the publicly listed companies can share their experiences and, of course, their journey. Everyone started from somewhere, and I guess it's important that the early reporters, the early adopters, could share their experiences and also lessons from sustainability reporting. So I guess that's what I can share. It's important that we also look at small and medium-sized entities because of the impact they create.
Okay, thank you. It's such a good concept with the big brother looking after the smaller brother. Ibu Rosita, how about in Indonesia?
Yeah, I think in Indonesia, we are now currently in the stage of mapping about what kind of skill that we need to build the capacity, because this is not financial reporting, right? This is a lot of skill that we need to build. Therefore, we need to identify first. And then in addition to that, we need to define a different training or capacity building program for each different profession or maybe community, like the one from the financial reporting angle, right? Like accountant, will be different set of the program compared to the usually prepare the sustainable reporting currently. Basically, it's not accountant. They are actually non-accountant, but doesn't understand about financial reporting. So I think this is the approach. And then after that, what I propose is actually if there is some countries or some thing outside Indonesia which already have this, right? And maybe has a good structure of the training program and capacity building, so we don't have to prepare from the scratch. I think really, really appreciate if we can share each other to speed up the process, Julia.
Thank you. I think that's a good idea. We should not be reinventing the wheel, right? And over to you, Dato.
Thanks, Julia. One of these Scriptures Commission's corporate governance strategic priorities for 2021 and 2023 was to strengthen the ESG fitness of boards so that they can discharge their duties effectively. So the changes and disruptions due to sustainability factors, particularly those related to climate, was and the directors need to have a good grasp of these issues. So what the Scriptures Commission did, and in collaboration with the Stock Exchange Bursa Malaysia and the Institute of Corporate Directors Malaysia, was to roll out the mandatory onboarding training program for directors on sustainability. We call it the Leading for Impact program, or LIP. So before that, we did a need analysis to identify the challenges faced by the directors in their oversight role. And then that basically helped us to design the program so that it's fit for purpose. So far, more than 300 directors have responded to the survey, with over 70% of them wanting the focus to be on sustainability governance, as well as sustainability performance targets and measures. So I think there's a lot of interest there. In terms of requirement, all directors on listed companies on Bursa Malaysia are required to attend this program, and newly appointed directors as well. So this program is very new. The first one was conducted on the 1st of August this year, with another 14 sessions to be conducted till end of this year. So far, we have seen about 1,000 directors having themselves registered for the program. So that's one on the SC's part. Also, under the JC3, which I mentioned to you, which is the Joint Committee on Climate Change, which is co-chaired between Bank Negara and Central Bank and the SC, there are several subcommittees within the JC3. And one of the committee is essentially dedicated at capacity building measures. And a number of workshops has been organized under that subcommittee. We are also planning to host the biennial Black Flagship Conference on climate change next month over 3 days. It's called the JC3 Journey to Zero Conference. So this regional conference will bring together a diverse range of climate experts, advocates, innovators, practitioners, and other stakeholders to discuss issues and challenges with climate and nature finance, hoping to can help the financial sector and its customers move from theory to practice. I think that's the focus of the program. Okay, Julia, I'll stop there.
All right, thank you. I think those are great initiatives. I especially like the one that is targeted for board of directors because they are the ones who will set the strategy for a transition pathway to sustainability first, right? So tone at the top is important. All right, lastly, over to you, Yen-san, and then I will also ask Mori-san to share about ISSB initiatives. Yeah.
Thanks, Julia. You know, based on the discussion earlier, you know, similar to all other countries, it's a whole of nation approach where we need to upskill quite a number of professions, you know, talents and, you know, to build up a sufficient capacity in time to come, both from the reporter perspective as well as from the, or, you know, the practitioner, you know, assurance practitioner perspective. So in Singapore context, our Ministry of Trade and Industry, in partnership with an agency called the Skill Future Singapore, has set up a Green Skill Committee that will drive Singapore effort in terms of developing skills and training programs required by green economy. So one of the work stream is actually led by our, led by ACRA, which will, as well as Enterprise Singapore, which is tasked to, you know, do a skill planning focusing on sustainability reporting and assurance. So that has been in the work. And specifically in terms of the various, you know, actual program that has been in place, we do have, you know, the director's training that has been imposed by the Singapore Exchange as well. That was mandated in March 2022, which requires all directors of a Singapore listed company to go through a mandatory training. Currently, there are 7 providers of such training and around 8 courses that is you know, eligible for the directors to attend. So that is one initiative that I think is very helpful to allow, you know, directors to understand the importance of sustainability as well as to drive, you know, the strategy discussion within the board, at the board level. So everything will start from the tone at the top. Second important initiative that has been happening is in terms of our Institute of Singapore Chartered Accountants, how they have taken up you know, the leadership in developing programs for both the assurance practitioner as well as you know, the professional accountants in business. So in terms of the program, they are planning to develop the sustainability professional and sustainability assurance professional certificate programs. This will be targeted both for the accounting as well as non-accounting professionals with different levels of competency. This will allow candidates to progress meaningfully based on their individual competency at this level, right? And the second part is targeted at those you know, accountants in practice. We call them the business professional business accountants. So this program is called the Professional Business Accountant Program. It is a program that was launched in 2019. So what ISCA is planning to do is to incorporate sustainability reporting into this program, you know, to infuse this into this program and to build a competency, you know, for the practice, for the public, for the so-called accountant in business to also learn about sustainability reporting. Of course, you know, ISCA also had, you know, short courses in terms of continuing professional education program, as well as develop technical resources and thought leadership. Example of thought leadership that's been launched is the ISCA Climate Disclosure Guide, you know, 5 steps in conducting climate-related scenarios. I think these are very useful guides, you know, for both, you know, the assurance practitioner as well as the preparers, you know, review, given, you know, such a reporting is so new in the marketplace. On top of that, I think, you know, Ibu Rusita, you brought up the point around having to look at a different profession because the skill set is quite wide. So our accountancy body also have MOUs and also working with other professions, including the legal professions, the engineers, as well as the Singapore Manufacturing Federation, you know, to build up a collaborative relationship, as well as to you know, to explore any synergies, to, you know, to work with this different organization, you know, to advance sustainability reporting in Singapore. Maybe Julia, I'll just pause here.
Yeah. Wow, that's quite a lot. I mean, now I'm really truly inspired. I hope that, you know, in the future, my children would have more choices than trying to become CPAs or chartered accountants. They can then go on to become certified sustainability experts, or maybe CSE in short. Right. Lastly, Komori-san, although you represent sort of ISSB, it's not global, if not jurisdictional specific, but I understand that ISSB also has many capacity building initiatives, and I'd like to invite you to share about it. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Julia. Yeah, so I should say that our job didn't end at all when we disclosed the S1 and S2 in June this year. So we are now moving towards the second stage. I would say that it is a capacity building job. So at the moment, we set up a partnership framework for capacity building, of which the member is IFAC and ACCA as well. So we really appreciate the support and advice, suggestions, and a proposal from outside ISSB. And also, we have been working very hard to the work of how to match the needs of SMEs in this region, and also emerging and developing market, capital market in this region as well. So my colleagues in London and Frankfurt and Montreal and China as well have been very much, talking each other what type of capacity building and what contents we need. So in that sense, we are now thinking of right now adoption guidance for regulators at each jurisdiction, and also educational materials for SMEs, such as to be posted on the Knowledge Hub on the ISSB website as well. So our effective date falls on the 1st of January next year. So this is a very important job towards our goal date. So towards end of this year, we will post one by one as soon as we can set up the educational materials and adoption guidance for the regulators and the SME companies as well. So, but at the moment, I think that I am not sure about very well about the content each one, but as soon as we set up one by one, I think that we will publicly disclose those kind of materials for everybody in a capital market. Yep. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you. Thank you all for sharing. They are all good examples of capacity building. And so I'm sort of moving on to my last theme. It's quite related, but you please feel free to offer a different perspective, right? So given that today's summit is an IFAC event, I also want to cover the important topic about the role of not just you as the accountant, or you as the profession, or you as the standard setter, right? But the role of the PAO in general in supporting the sustainability agenda. So my question to maybe Yen-san, to Benji, to Ibu, Rosita, you know, referring again back to the four challenges that IFAC has defined, can you share what are some initiatives that the PAOs in your jurisdictions are doing to address those challenges? Yeah. Benji, would you like to start first?
Okay, thanks, Julia. So I mentioned the Philippines Sustainability Reporting Committee. So that is being led by the big accounting firms. So I guess that's really one of the initiatives where we contribute in this space. But in addition to that committee, I think the accountants are well positioned in terms of engaging publicly listed companies, especially we always have a voice in boardrooms whenever we present financial statement audit results. So we also about ESG risk and how that impact organizations. So I guess that's also another way through engagement of stakeholders, especially investors. We also have I guess, relationship with close relation with regulators. So in that way, we can share leading practices in the area or in the region or globally. And also, I guess, share with them feedback from our clients, like challenges, so that they don't just adopt verbatim the standards, but they also try to balance the, I guess, readiness of reporters in the market. And finally, engagement also with academe, as I mentioned, it's important to look at the supply. We don't have enough sustainability practitioners for accounting firms, for corporates, and we really need them to really advance the level of reporting. And finally, as accountants, since accounting is the language of business, so we can also help, I guess, translate environmental and social risk into financial risk, so that I guess business people can understand more easily ESG.
All right. Thanks, Benji. Ibu?
Yeah, I think, Julia, in Indonesia, there are three main roles that I think the PAO can do. The first one is standard setting, because we have the mandate, right? I think that's a very important role, and driving the roadmap together with the regulators. Number two is the facilitation to coordinate and collaboration with all stakeholders in Indonesia, preparers, regulators, even academicians, because now IAI has several compartments. One of them is the compartment for the lecturer. So we are already built the awareness for them, so they can think about how to change the syllabi for the university to include even this topic, the sustainability reporting, right? And number three definitely is capacity building. We are thinking about training program, and also number two is certification. I think that's three major roles that we can play on this topic.
All right, that's quite a lot. And over to you, Yensan.
Yeah. So in terms of the PAOs, I think we do have a lot to bring to the table. As we have a lot of CFOs, and they are all represented across different industries and different companies. And therefore, you know, they are in the best place to influence as well as to participate in sustainability reporting and support the whole process. In fact, with the ISSB standards focusing more on connectivity between the financial statements and the sustainability report, I think it makes it more important for the accountants and the CFO to be involved and drive the process, because, you know, a lot of the financial effect will actually be brought to the front, and perhaps more scrutiny over the financial effects of the company. Therefore, you know, CFOs, have a big role to play. And CFOs are all, you know, in the Singapore context, you know, part and parcel of the accounting community. And a lot of them are members of ISCA, you know, accountancy committee. And at ISCA itself, clearly, you know, ISCA being the, you know, accountancy body has a big role to play in terms of, bringing all the CFO together, setting thought leaderships, building capacity, building talents, upskilling the CFO, upskilling the assurance professional to help, you know, deliver this sustainability reporting in a quality manner in due course. In terms of, you know, the profession, you know, ourselves among the large network, I think we also contribute quite significantly, both at the global level supporting the standard setters at the ISSB as well as the, you know, IFAD level. At the same time, locally, I think we also need to contribute to the professional body in terms of, infusing our knowledge and helping to build up the local ecosystem. I think that's very important, you know, and a role that I think, you know, we should be able to contribute to. At the same time, of course, there are also various other organizations, global organizations like the ACCA. So ACCA has been forefront of sustainability reporting, you know, working quite closely with the ISSB in developing some of the, you know, trade, you know, explain us on ISSB when the standards first come out. In addition to that, they also have a separate work stream looking at developing insights on the practical implementation of the standards that they are working on, including an area called integrated thinking. So I think, you know, with all these various organizations coming together, we should be able to bring the reporting, you know, to a better place in a couple of years' time.
Okay, great. I think your message about the CFO really resonated well with the audience. In case you didn't see it, you receive a heart when you mentioned that. Right, just moving on to Komori-san, you know, standard setting, particularly as it relates to accounting, auditing, and ethical standards are often involved, PAOs. So my question to you is, what can PAOs do to become an effective bridge in cascading down the objective that global standard setters such as ISSB wishes to achieve when standards are locally adopted?
Yeah, thank you, Julia. A very important question. As I said, our partnership framework for capacity building very much, and we very much appreciate the membership of IFAC and ACCA in that organization as a PAO. And so we really look forward to further working together with those of the representative of our accounting industries to solve the question of capacity building issue. And as well, awareness of S1 and S2 in this region, and also ongoing assurance issue is quite critical to us as well. So I very much appreciate the great job and the contribution of the not only PAOs, but also accountants overall, particularly in this region, towards our goal to be endorsed by, adopted by, and adopted by every jurisdiction in this region in future. So I personally feel very looking forward to working together, continuing to get working together with those PAOs and in this region and accountants in this region. Although I very much impressed their talent and capability and the eagerness of the accountant towards the sustainability issues right now. I didn't know many accountants at all at the GPIF and my previous jobs, but I am completely surrounded by accountants, not only this office, but also wherever I go. So, but I really appreciate the great contribution, including you, Julia, to our
thank you.
Our ISSB ambition in future. Right. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And lastly, Dato, you know, on a separate topic, I really love Komori-san's sentence about accountants, but on a separate topic, I wanted to say that, you know, the SC is actually hosting IOSCO's first Asia Pacific hub in Kuala Lumpur to help deliver capacity building activities for securities regulators. So, you know, I wanted to ask you, are there best practices that you see from this IOSCO model that IFAC and APAC PAOs can emulate in respect of cross-border knowledge sharing and peer knowledge sharing? Yeah.
Thanks, Julia. But before that, I'd just like to share with Komori-san that you're not alone. And thanks, Julia, for the question on IOSCO Hub. It seems to me like a get off jail card for me, since I'm no accountant and can't really talk about much about the profession. But certainly, I can share about what happened, what's happening at this Asia Pacific Hub, which is the first regional hub of IOSCO outside its headquarters in Madrid, and has been in operation since 2017. Basically for capacity building for securities regulators in the Asia-Pac region. To date, it has trained over 1,800 individuals from 120 jurisdictions in various areas, including sustainable finance. So if you're talking about anything, which I'll try to share, whether it will be something of use for IFAC and the IPAC PAO, some of the key approaches adopted by the hub include top-down and bottom-up approach, where the hub ensures relevance and effectiveness of its capacity building activities by planning its activities for the year based on the needs that have been identified through feedback from IOSCO members in the region, as well as emerging market. After getting the feedback from members in the region, what the hub normally do is that it will also seek input from IOSCO headquarters in Madrid to design and deliver the capacity building program so that it's in line with the IOSCO's overall priorities. So you try to maintain that alignment with the IOSCO HQ in Madrid. Secondly, very often the hub collaborates with international bodies, including the International Financial Reporting Standards, World Bank, IMF, in its capacity building program. Thirdly, there's a lot of sharing of course, and among the regulators, sharing of expertise and experience to foster cross-border knowledge, sharing and exchange of best practices. So, basically participants are able to learn from each other, share insights, and connect with subject matter experts to facilitate development and implementation of various frameworks that's happening in their respective jurisdictions. The other thing that I would like to share in terms of the practices when they do undertake the programs at the hub, include they have, for example, where the, some of the program by way of interactive simulation, which have been well received. And this has been done in relation to one of their cyber resilient workshop that was conducted by IOSCO and IMF in May of this year. So I think, so it's not one way, it's I think a very participatory involvement by participants in the program. The other thing is also sometimes it can go very technical, because again it caters for the specific need of the group of jurisdictions within this region, so they can go very very technical by bringing the relevant expertise. Again, sometimes they will also source it from the multilaterals and other standard setting bodies. Yeah. Okay, I think, Julia, I think there's some of the development that I can share with regard to the IOSCO Asia PAC Hub.
Okay, thank you. And I think those are very useful because that will sort of give us some insights into how PAOs, IFAC, ISSB should work together to sort of build capacity and to help promote the ISSB standards in this region. All right, so I think I'm sort of come to the end of the four topics that I wanted to cover. So Tania just wanted to check if we can go straight into the Q&A.
Yes, yes, we can go straight into the Q&A. Thank you so much, Julia. I'll select some of the questions and then we'll go from there. So one of them said that noted the stakeholders involved are around capital providers, corporations, regulators, and reporting professionals. So since climate and sustainability involves applying the right science, how much is the involvement of the scientific community to ensure we are applying the right science and not based on popular, well-lobbied views only? So that's one question. And addressed to all panelists, I would believe. So I will leave it to the panelists to jump in and answer and give your thoughts and perspectives.
Yeah, Tania, maybe I can give it a shot. So I guess the level of involvement of the scientific community would vary. So of course, some of the organizations would be able to hire from universities, these people with the right background. But oftentimes the direction is to hire consultants with I guess the right credentials also. Because especially in the decarbonization space, especially when you talk about net zero commitments, a lot of it would be driven by science-based targets and I guess also the roadmap. So I guess that's how companies engage scientific people through consultants if they're not able to hire internally.
If I may jump, Julia?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So I think if we are looking about the sustainable reporting, if we want to have a high quality sustainable reporting, one of the major and critical issue is measurement, right? So I think we have to acknowledge that to be able to have a comparability on this reporting, we need to ensure this community, the scientific, which will contribute significantly to the measurement, has also the same perspective about this, right? Has the same understanding about this standard and also understanding about the impact, right? Otherwise, it's going to be not comparable, right? So if my opinion, it's very important. Now my question is, because this community is not something currently in Indonesia, we don't have like association of scientific, right? So it's a very diverse community, right? So the challenge is how to gather all of them and ensure that they have speak and have the common language. I think the struggling from us, right? I don't know if other country can share how to make this happen.
Yeah, so that's a very good comment, Ibu. Actually, you know, this would probably come up in your roadmap as you consider the licensing or accreditation of assurance providers. So I can ask Yensan to briefly comment, because I think in Singapore, they are proposing to sort of accredit providers under a uniform framework. And that will be one way of gathering all these scientific-based experts.
Yeah, hey, thanks, Julia. So in terms of the assurance provider, given that, you know, the SRAC or the recommendation includes having assurance in the coming years, so there's a need also to ensure that there's, you know, accreditation or licensing of climate auditors. So in terms of the licensing requirement, the proposal requires, you know, certain number of hours, you know, for the climate auditor to clock, let's say, for example, the continuing professional education hours, at the same time, you know, necessary experience during a certain period of time. There is a one-off transition, which is a bridging course will need to be attended, for example, for public accountants, existing registered public accountants, to, you know, get themselves, to have more knowledge in terms of sustainability to allow them to, you know, get themselves accredited as a climate auditor as a one-off transition relief. So I think that was, you know, some of the mechanism that's been put in place to ensure that the pool of people that ultimately become an assurance provider has the necessary competency or capability to do the work. Back to the issue around scientific involvement, I think climate scenario is probably one of the areas that requires a lot more scientific inputs, given that, you know, this knowledge will probably lies beyond, you know, the typical knowledge of a typical accountant, right? And given that climate scenario analysis, I think, you know, is a journey that many companies will need to go through. The IWSBO standard itself does allow, you know, a step approach, a phase approach in terms of doing the climate scenario, starting with a qualitative and going drilling down to more detail in the subsequent years. So I think this is an area where Ibu Rasita say that we don't really have, you know, a centralized body of climate scientists or a professional body called climate scientists at this moment. But I think this, you know, given that this is a phased approach in terms of reaching the end goal of having a more robust climate scenario analysis being reported, I think we can take this couple of years to start up build up this process and as well as this work stream to get the involvement of you know, the appropriate climate scientists. And also I think in terms of climate scenario, there needs to be some thinking around having some consistency by jurisdiction. I mean, you know, the climate scenario should be quite consistent in each jurisdiction. I think there's still some works to be done. And I think, you know, we do have, you know, given the phased approach, I think we can take, you know, time during these couple of years to look into this area involving the specific people with the necessary knowledge, you know, that will help to drive consistency. And I think global, you know, global effort to help with this will be extremely helpful because, you know, it will require each jurisdiction to have their own climate scenario because each jurisdiction will have their own different, you know, different way, different impact arising from climate. As you can see, I'm not a climate scientist, right? So I think, you know, this is definitely an important area for us to achieve some form of consistency in terms of, you know, climate scenario analysis in the years to come.
Okay, thank you.
Julia, and maybe then, I can add on. I think, because I think the question was the involvement of the scientific community. I suppose, you know, the within the financial services sector, you know, I think as we talk about, you know, it's all your usual suspects in there. You know, your accountant, your lawyers, et cetera, et cetera. But I think for us in Malaysia, I think we do rely on the relevant ministries that are in charge of climate change, et cetera. For example, we have the Natural Resources and Environment and Climate Change Ministry that does come out with, you know, so some of those scientific discussions relating to climate change, et cetera, can emanate from there. And I think it's useful to have a focal point on that. We also have the Ministry of Economics, which also recently launched the NETA, which is the National Energy Transformation Roadmap. So those we look at that as being a development that would have been supported by scientific work behind it. So that would provide us in Malaysia as the guidance for us in our sustainability work as well.
Yep. Okay. Great. Thanks. I thought those were very good responses. Unfortunately, I think we would like to be able to answer all the questions that were asked, but I was told that we need to wrap up by 1 p.m. So before I close the panel, maybe I can ask each of our panelists just to sort of give us a short word of encouragement to the audience here in terms of how we should achieve, how we should attempt to implement the ISSB standards in our respective countries. Maybe starting with, maybe I can start off with Benji.
Yeah, thank you, Julia. So I guess just a quick word of encouragement. ISSB, I guess, ushers in the future of corporate reporting, where we see integrated financial statements and sustainability report. So I guess let's have a very open mindset and be able to realize the opportunities in this journey.
Thank you. Yen-san?
Yeah. Thanks, Julia. Yeah, I think, you know, we all need to start somewhere. Right. It's not a difficult exercise. We just need to open our mind and be open-minded in terms of learning new things. And I think we need to go on approach that, you know, sustainability reporting is probably a continuous learning exercise. And there's no end to the journey, given the topic is very wide. But so long as we continue to learn, take that step forward, I think we can make it happen.
All right. Thank you. Ibu?
Yeah, I think this is a new era of corporate reporting. And we need to believe that this new era of sustainability reporting can drive the company or organization to have a more robust initiative on the ESG. So the climate change impact is real here and now. As accountant, our role is very important in this new era of sustainability reporting. So in our various role and capacity, I would like to encourage, let's take part in ensuring a better future for our children. Start now. I would like to encourage your sustainability reporting journey now. I know it is a very challenging journey, but it is a step-by-step journey. And the last but not the least, let's work together, help and support each other to achieve our common goal to have a comparable, high quality and integrated sustainability reporting era. That's from me, Julia.
Thank you. Dato?
I think as I mentioned earlier, the establishment of the ISSB and the issuance of the two standards are a significant step moving forward. So this is one which is widely, and I think it's mentioned just now, that was supported by IOSCO and to be used as the common language to report and value sustainability risks and opportunity. This consistency and comparability is important to move capital faster, limit greenwashing, and underpin the credibility of the sustainable finance agenda. And certainly, this require pivot updates and changes to the frameworks, policies, as well as practices. And I'm reminded again of another quote, this one by Charles Darwin. It's not the strongest, nor the most intelligent species that survive. It's the one that are most adaptable to change. And on the side, you know, I would also like to thank Komori-san for the offer to tap on the transition implementation group should there be any queries on the interpretation on the standards. Thanks, Julia. That's all I have.
Thank you. And lastly, Komori-san.
Thank you, Julia. Thank you again. Thank you for having me here today with a great opportunity for the ISSB to express what we made and what purpose for that and what we are aiming at in future. So I'm in Tokyo right now and very much looking forward to each of you in person soon. And again, thank you very much for the great discussion and very much inspired to know that Mr. Hashimoto, I'm not alone in this market. Thank you very much.
Right. So thank you for all your insights. I just want to sort of remind us again about the key topics that have been discussed. I think harmonization is really an important topic that all the panelists brought up. Integrated reporting is also another topic. Also to have a value creation mindset, that's important. Capacity building in terms of people. And a gentle reminder from Komori-san, let's take a climate first approach, not a climate only approach. So there will be more to come. Right. So I just want to thank you for all your time, your attention for this session. And I think it has been a wonderful session. Thank you very much. Back to you, Tanya.
Thank you so much for this session today. I want to thank you, Julia, Hiroshi, Jensen, Rosita, Dato, Kumaruddin, Benjamin, for your profound insights on ISSB 1 and S1 and S2 and the implications they hold for sustainability disclosures. With such a riveting panel discussion, and your expertise has undoubtedly enriched our understanding and highlighted the critical role that these standards play in fostering transparency and accountability in sustainability reporting. And to all participants, thank you so much for your thoughtful engagement and questions that added depth to our discourse. For the questions that we could not answer, we have kept a log of these questions and we may put together a written Q&A post-webinar document and then share that with you along with the recording. So I'd like to say again, if you haven't registered for tomorrow's session, please do so. It'll be at 2 p.m. Singapore time. And I encourage you to join us tomorrow as we will explore assurance of sustainability reporting. And I'd also like to express our sincere gratitude to our co-hosts, Afa, Kappa, Safa, and the Jeju Group for their instrumental support and their contributions in making today's dialogue a success. So I'm looking forward to seeing you all tomorrow as we uncover more insights and reinforce our commitment to a sustainable future. So we will see you tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a nice day, everyone. Bye.
Thank you very much.